Friday. Let's talk about Friday. So, I was rendering out an XCOM 2 video, and I came back to the computer to find out that it had somehow managed to crash Adobe Premiere Elements, which never happens. And then, a little bit later, I was watching, I think it was one of Kim's pajama streams or something, and suddenly everything goes. And I realized that Elemental probably was right when he mentioned to me that his hard drive was failing. So then I had to jury-rig a system for D&D on the Saturday night. I had to postpone the Undermine monthly event on the Sunday, and then I finally managed to get delivered a new hard drive on the Sunday as well, and I've been setting that up since. So things are a bit messy at the moment. So consequently, I don't have programming set up, so I can't do Yog Dwarves tonight, but I can do this stuff. So, for those of you unawares, I've been working on like the plan for Undermine's next map, because it's getting old and it needs to be kind of like shifted over and replaced and updated and all this stuff. Let's just can I tell you to that's gone. Good. And my idea is the Spring Realms. So, for those of you who don't know, the Spring Realms are sort of a Skylands map, where you'll be able to have a value called Spirit that enables you to go temporarily into spectator mode for transit. And there'll be some islands that you can build on that don't reset, but there'll be others that are usually like the ones you go to mine stuff that are fully like, that they will just occasionally restore themselves. And there'll also be dungeons. And the dungeons are an important thing because the world border, let's see if I remember this, set 2000? No? Less than that? Okay. 1000? I suppose I can't see it yet, actually. I still got it way too high. Hang on, let me do this a bit more properly. So, world, border, center, bloop, and bloop. Oh, I know what's happening. Hang on. Oh, and I know why it's happening. I just realized I've got the command block, like, outputs turned off. And if I turn the output back on, I'm gonna see a whole ton. So let's see, where am I? Call it 750, negative 150. And then set 50. There we go. So yeah, Spirit Realms, well, Spring Realms, I keep getting the two mixed up, has a world border. And when you first kill a given boss, it expands. So, for example, world border at 50. It expands, and I can set that to be like a time. So, it expands gradually, which looks really nice, but takes longer, obviously. And that means that over time you'll be able to get access to other islands further out, away from the actual center. The center, of course, being the spring. And the spring is responsible for actually being the world spawn, as well as being the first island and where you chiefly get your spirit in the early days. Let's just set that back to 1000, shall we? There we go. We fly over here, we can still see it, probably. But yeah, the main like hallmark of this thing is going to be these huge islands. So some people were concerned when I came up with the idea that I would be basically putting everyone into a sky block. Is the stream low quality for anyone else? It might be because I have lost like all of the settings I had on OBS and everything else, so I'm probably gonna have to do a little bit of catching up to fix that. But it looks good on my end. I'm not seeing any like dropped frames. So if there is a problem, it's probably something I have not managed to fix just yet. I had to rebuild this whole thing from scratch. But yeah, some people were afraid that I was gonna put them all in Skyblock, and Skyblock has been done to death. And The answer to that is no. A few of us were worried that I would just put them in like an area that might invoke vertigo, which I can understand. But no, this is the kind of scale of island I was thinking of. So, to make this, as well as the Mega Tiger one over there, the forest one over there, there's a mesa over here, I think. I haven't gotten all the islands I want just yet. And yeah, there's the mesa one, just loading into view. And way over here there is also a Mushroom Island version. Yeah, I figure you probably have like maybe six different like buildings here, six different bases on an island this size before you started to get remotely cramped. And there's going to be about 16 of them currently planned, and there'll be different like there'll be different versions, like different biomes. So as I say, I've got the Mega Tiger, the Sunflower Plains, the Forest, the Mesa, and just floating into view over there is the Mushroom Island. And these actually do retain their biome settings. So you can see right now it's registering I'm in a desert. And if I fly over to here, ocean, and then Mushroom Island, shore, that kind of thing. So they do actually retain their spawns and their settings and all sorts. So the Mushroom Island is still dominantly like mob free, even if I was to turn this to night and turn up the difficulty up. If there's mesa, there's possibly cacti on it. There is also going to be a desert one. I just didn't have time to stick that one in. But the way I made these was the end generation has changed in recent history. So I went back a few versions. I generated a couple different end dimensions. I encased, like, I got rid of all of the pillars, the obsidian, the monsters, that kind of thing. And then I went to MC Edit, I encased it in bedrock, and then I got rid of the end stone, leaving just the void where the island had been. And from there, I just pasted that over to a few locations in the world, over a few different biomes, and I got these lovely, like, these beautiful skylands, if you will. Dark air tree, give us the forbidden cacti. Yeah, you're not gonna be wanting for, like, materials. Like, look, there's a cactus right there, and there, and there, and there, and there, and there. You're not gonna be wanting as much for materials. You will have to obviously worry about, like, where you're building, because as I say, some areas will reset, removing all player, like, modification. And they're usually meant to be the ones that people are going to be harvesting anyways, but yeah. Exactly, Bamboo, just like using molds. In fact, that's exactly what the folder of them is called. I have 8 of those currently. They're all called molds. I also have the raw islands on file, just in case I want to dig those out. And some of these are going to have, like, water hanging off the edge, because why not? But something somebody was worried about was what would happen if you went over the edge. So we are just going to set up a quick little command block that will fix that up perfectly well. So, let me see. One cactus is more cacti than Undermine. Yeah. How do we know if an island will regen? They'll usually be smaller ones. Like, they will not be nearly the scale of that one. But other than that, it should be, like, fairly apparent. Please say that there is a wolf island, I will live there forever. Well, since they all retain their biomes, wolves will spawn on them, so yay. Let me see. I want slash test 4 at a, let's see, I want x equals blip minus 1000, we'll say, y equals 1, z equals minus 1000. I'm just trying to remember exactly how this selector works. Target selectors, that's what I want. Okay, so yeah, what I'm looking for here is to select everybody who's on the Y level of 1, or within the range of it. And so let's see, Rx equals 2000, Rz equals 2000, and Ry equals 1. And this should return true once, as soon as it finds somebody, but we'll see. someone's gonna figure out how to fall out of the world somehow. Well, that's entirely, like, the purpose of this particular one. So, let's see. Execute. Blub, blub, blub. Say, too low. Whoops. As, like, our test. So, I'm currently at level 4. 2, 1. And, oh, evidently, I have gotten this command a little bit wrong. So, let me hop into one of my overworlds that I have running around here. I wish I could remember which one it was. It's gonna be one of these ones. Haven't died yet in the current Undermine. Nope, not that one. I've got 3 of these just from trying out various things. I think it was this one. No, but I'm getting closer. This one. If there's an end, if there's a never board, I know I'm on the right one. Yes, there we go. Blech. Okay. D, not R. That's what I was looking for. Okay. Now I know. Boats plus far fallen equals falling into the voids. Yeah, that's happened a few times. So, distance X, distance Y. There. So now if I go down here. Always active, repeat. I still got this wrong. Nope, I apparently still have this wrong. Interesting. I'm still getting to grips with these new command blocks, but let's just copy that thing wholesale, shall we? So then, to here again. I had a bit more of a functional system set up, but this does what we're looking for, at the very least. Okay, so 750 minus 140 should about do that. Just want to put those in before I get teleported in the middle of nowhere. Okay. There we go. So that, whenever you get too close to the bottom, teleports you right out. Now, I can also make this set a actual variable. So, let's see. Scoreboard objectives list. We've currently got falling, water marker, spirited, spiriting, and in water. Now, I think I have... Yeah, so here's, like, the full version. So, this sets the score of everyone who is detected to be too close to the void of falling to 1. And then, into here, we teleport everyone who is in that condition away. We set their score to 2 in falling, so that we know that we don't need to teleport them again. We tell them, oh hey, mind your step, and then we set their falling score back to 0. So, what happens is you fall down, your score of falling goes to 1. So let's put scoreboards, objectives, set display, sidebar, falling. So, your score of falling on the side here gets set to 1. You then get teleported. You then get your score set to 2. You get told you were falling out of the world, and then you get it set back to 0. Where's a hat to protect my true self who's piloting that fleshback? So, currently, this is decided not to be doing anything. Always active, repeat. Oh, because this is currently set to be only if you're in survival mode. So if I go to game mode 0, which is survival mode, I can drop down here. Whoops, mind your step. Perfect. So what I can also do is I can make that take a little bit of your spirit if you have at least that much. So let's see, scoreboard set display back to spirit. Yeah, spirited. There we go. So, let's shuffle that a little bit. And let's just have that be always active. Chain. Chain ones all happen like one after the others, which makes this a lot easier. Okay. So, scoreboard players remove at A, score falling min equals 2, and score spirited min equals, let's say, 100. And 100 from spirited. So, if I have that correct, scoreboard players remove. Objective, then the number. So, spirited 100. Okay, yeah. So now, if I go to game mode 0, you can see my value on spirited right now is 300. If I drop down here, I lost 100 spirits, but I didn't fall into the void. So, nice. So that basically means as long as I have 100 spirit to lose, it will still teleport me, but it'll also cost me a bit of spirit, so I will never go to zero. Nice. And I can also make that a little bit more forgiving by saying you have to have a minimum of, say, 150 or 200 before it starts taking it away. So, set that to 75, set that to 150. So you have to have at least 150, and then it'll remove it. So it never takes you below 100, shall we say. Yeah, never takes you below 100 spirit. So it's 50 spirits to fall into the void, provided you actually have that much. Either way, you get saved. The difference is how long you'll be spending stood next to the actual, like, source of spirit. Phew. They say on Dev Island there are towers constructed from endless power. So you said about special wither skulls to boost our spectator, but what about ways to regain spirit on our islands? That probably will be something to distinguish, like, the player, like, construction zone islands. There'll be, like, little things that can do for that. There'll also be various things you can do to get more spirit, but I'm trying to not name things exactly specifically yet, because I don't want them to be farmable. Like, there should be some way that you can get more spirit, but there shouldn't be a way that you can just get spirit just as writ. That shouldn't happen. But anyways, so that is how the not falling out of the world protection works. In fact, I will even make a hole there and just demonstrate how safe this is. Perfectly fine. Not a worry in the world. Lovely. But now I have no spirit, so I guess now I need to show how you get spirit from the spirits, like, from the spring itself. Island looks vaguely like a whale. I can kind of see it from this angle. But there's more than one island, of course. These are all different molds as well. Spirit stalks, a new crop. E. Does look like a whale. Yeah, a little bit. Also, hi, Twangy. Good to see you. Okay. So, here we have the system that actually, like, sets your spirit score. So from this we are setting everybody, we're removing one from everyone's score who is her score of in water, which is at least one. So it'll go to zero and then no lower. Here we are detecting, we're executing on all players, we're detecting if they're standing in a water block, and if they are, it sets their scoreboard of value in water to 2. So how convenient that this segues directly to the next command blockchain. Yeah. And then around all these water markers, every like water marker, we just display a few particles so you know where you'll be getting your actual value. So let's see, scoreboard, objectives, set display, sidebar in water. So I've currently got a scoreboard value of 0 there. And now it's a 2, it occasionally dips to 1, but it stays there quite happily. Okay, that was an interesting one. Anyways, do I have some mods around? Come to think of it. Yeah, Aeneas and Sakura. Anyways, so yes, standing in water, this is able to detect when you're doing it. So from there, we have this command. And this is on a slow timer. This is still a lot faster than it should be. But this just checks for everyone who is, like, within a range of the water markers, and who is in water, so lip, and whose spirit is not quite too high, and they're not in spectator mode. That adds to your spirit score. But to do that, I actually need to have an object, like a reference point here. So let's see. Scoreboard players set at E type equals armor stand water marker 1. So there we go, he's got his little particles. I'm still working out what entity to use for this, because so far I haven't found one that doesn't actually get pushed around by water. And if they can get pushed around by water, they can get stolen by people. So that's the thing. So if I stand in here, I'm now in water 2, and see my spirit score is gradually ticking up. So it'll go as high as 300, and that's about as far as it'll go. Okay. And then, now that I have my spirit score, I can either fall into the ground, I can fall into the void of impunity, not that I have much concern there either. So there's a max spirit. There is a max spirit that the spring, will give you. Because, like, it's slow, and it goes up to, like, a reasonable level, but it stops. Like, it's not where you go to just, like, build up spirit. But there's a bunch of ways you can get spirit otherwise. There isn't, to my knowledge, currently I haven't planned any, like, actual, like, top value. So, ethereal brew. Enter an ethereal state to travel great distances. So, with that, I've now got some spirit, I drink this, and with a little flash, I turn into spectator mode, and you can see my spirit is ticking down. And with this, we can travel some substantial speeds and distances, but I also have an alert that I'm going to be rematerializing soon, so there we go. Ha! So, ordinarily, we would have, like, so basically what would happen is, you spawn in, you get your spirit from the spring, you also, like, get an ethereal brew, and from there, you can fly off in spectator mode to wherever you want to go. You can also sit here once you die, for example, to, like, regain all of your stuff. And what we want to do as well is take the, like, get ethereal brews, because you only get one when you start off. So we want to next set up a little thing to detect, let me see, do we want awkward potions maybe? No, probably just glass bottles. Or maybe, I'm trying to think what would be like the most obvious thing. Water bottle, either a water bottle or a glass bottle. I think a glass bottle makes the most sense. So you chuck a glass bottle into here, like near one of the water markers, and it will actually detect what your, it'll detect it and make ethereal brew, basically. So scoreboard objectives, set display, sidebar in water. Does this actually already detect this? I don't think it does. No, it doesn't. Okay. So, we need a new little system to detect that. So with that, we want to go to this, and let's see, execute on at E type equals item, detect whether it is that, and let's see, so from all, like, items we want to detect this, set in water to 2, and let's just see how that does for us, and it doesn't seem to be grabbing it. So it's detecting water at 0. But it's not detecting that. Interesting. Okay. Probably because it's going for... Hang on, was that saying my score? No. Okay. Oh. What am I losing? what am I missing here? What's going on in chat? Can the little particles be small spirit fairies, please? Not exactly, like, easy to do, because I would need to make custom particles. And I will probably have to do, like, a little bit of custom stuff, but I'd rather keep that to my level, ideally. But anyways, so we're trying to detect all water, all like, bottled entities that are actually, like, in water. So... slash test for at e type equals item. And of course we can't see the output here, so let me just turn these off. Slash game rule command block output, I think it is. Whoop. There. Okay. Nope. test for type equals item. Found a glass bottle. Okay. And we want to set a scoreboard value to those. Actually, no, what we want to be doing ideally for them is just changing them out already. So, start very simply with TP at e type equals item blip blip 5 blocks up. That should make it 15. And can I just say this? How can lying wearing a hat but it's so warm? Just how? Flippy hat. Eh, it's my polar bear hat. It's like very very appropriate when things are hot. So this just teleports all the items 15 blocks up, or they would, except that it's currently let's see, distance 10. So, no? Distance 15? Interesting, it's stopped teleporting that one. Hmm. I find it very interesting. Oh, can I switch to that? I see. So that is just, like, checking to teleport all the items. Let's do that. We should presumably see it fall from the heavens soon enough. But we want to actually, like, firstly turn that off. Blip. It'll land eventually. Very eventually. I'm not quite sure exactly where it's ended up. It may have just ceased to exist. That's entirely possible as well. Maybe I have an Arco? You mean an air conditioner? No. I definitely do not have an air conditioner. TP at a type equals item at P. Oh, there you are. Never mind, it finally landed. Okay. So, if it's within 5 blocks, teleport it to 15 blocks above that. So now we can see it's actually doing that, which is a start. So next, what we actually want to do is detect them, is detect where they are. So, slash execute at e type equals item. Do detect, let's say like snow, that seems like the most obvious thing for me. And let me just bring up the slash execute, documentation. Okay. Detect blip blip blip. Say minus one. And we want Minecraft. Is it snow? I'm trying to think. Yeah, it is just snow. Data zero. In which case, TP 5 blocks up. So now it is no longer detecting any such items that meet that requirement. So what's going on, I wonder? Let's see, game rule. There's one specifically for. I think it's log admin commands. Log admin commands. True. Okay. But yeah, I don't have AC or a fan or anything in here because it makes noise. And, like, if you can see, like, that, there's like four of those in here, and they're all to reduce noise and echo. So consequently, having air conditioning in here would A, be expensive, and B, be completely at odds with what I actually need to achieve down here. Okay, so, let's... Fail to execute detect. Okay. So there's my first problem that I need to fix up. So, do-do-do-do-do. Execute, where are you? There you are. Okay. Examples. I'm sure I have this right. Yeah, I've got the syntax right, and it's detecting the bottle, obviously. It's just not doing anything else. Fail to execute the TP. Okay, so that identified it. That's a start. Say, hello stream. Okay, there we go, that's progress. So what we need to do is identify only ones that are also, where in England, whatever is you, we're usually called. I did it before I had AC, but I didn't know, know some of them made me suffer. Oh dear. Yeah, we're currently in the middle of a heat wave in England, so yeah. Right, anyways. Evidently teleporting is not something you should do. But should be able to set scoreboard value. So let's add a new objective. And let's see what. Add. And we'll call it empty bottle of type dummy. So scoreboard objectives set display sidebar. What did I call it? I believe I called it empty bottles, didn't I? Yeah, empty bottle. Did that not already exists? Okay, good. So currently nothing like exists. So scoreboard objectives, or scoreboard players, set at E, and want to set empty bottle score to 1. And we're not seeing that actually get set. Interesting. So let's go back up here. Oh, because that was the one we messed up. There we go. That is unfortunately every item on the map. Although I am seeing a lot of glass bottles. Slash tp at e type equals item. Interesting, that's a lot of empty bottles. Oh, that's setting every entity, isn't it? Scoreboard players remove at E. Empty bottle. Scoreboard objectives remove empty bottle. Okay, so we need to identify all the items on the ground that are, firstly, items, and secondly, are holding an empty bottle. Two main numbers and dashes. Yeah, those are all entity IDs, in short. Okay, so that is good. Let's just add our empty bottle there. And set our display again so we can see it. Okay, so now we've just got the one. And it goes away as soon as the empty bottle doesn't exist. So what we need to find is those that are in water. So, wherever you are, let's check for water. And now we don't have anything, but if I drop it in here, there we go. Now we have an essentially an in-water score for items. And again, we need to actually make specify that this is only for only for items that contain like actual bottles. So target selector is what we want. And let's see, scores, tags, targets by teams, like targets by count, experience level, game mode, name. Might be able to, data tags are what I'm mostly looking for. So for that, I need to know the data tags of items or item entities as well. See, item entities, there we go. Tim has been dognapped. Hey? Oh no! Right, so item. So for that we need ID. So item ID, that's a compound tag. So ID Minecraft, just put empty bottle, I think. Glass bottle. Glass underscore bottle. Okay. See how that does. Whoop. So currently that ain't doing the job. And also this is setting like every item, so r equals 1, or at p should work, but that's only for like the that only applies to players, I believe. It's the closest player. Yeah, target's the nearest player, which is not what we want. We want the nearest entity. We ideally want the entity executing. So type equals item r equals 1. So that should at least try to get the ones that are, like, there. But this evidently isn't working, so we need to do a little bit of test for experimentation. So test for at e type equals item. Item id glass bottle. Gospel did not read the required data structure. Hello. That's useful. So let's take a look. Entity data at e type equals item lib. So data did not change. That's fine. So this is the part that we're looking for here. Minecraft glass bottle. I'm not seeing anything there, but it means it matched the data structure, which is good. So if we change this to that, and we're missing a bracket by the looks of it. There we go. So now, that bottle is doing the trick, but the stone isn't, because it is not an item, or rather, it is not an empty bottle. So there we go. Good. Progress is made. Haha. So then, we want to make that into an actual, like that. That is now detecting empty bottles that are in the water. So with that, we can change the use of empty bottle here into an actual like scoreboard value. And from there, we just need to make sure that everything plays out nicely. So item score empty bottle. My guy has very much kind of bottles? Yeah, yeah. Jeez, I'm talking at breakneck speed. Okay, score empty bottle, minimum. We'll say empty bottle less than zero, less than or equal to zero. Which shouldn't break that, but let's take a look. Okay, no, it does. Just my luck. Ultimately, we can just use empty bottle as an identifier itself, and then use a different value to check for everything else that we need. So, slash scoreboard objectives, add, and let's say conversion timer, or just conversion, makes the most sense. So, dummy, add a chain here. So, from every like empty bottle that currently has a score, like that we've recognized. So, let me see. Ow. Doesn't need redstone, unconditional. So we want scoreboard. Actually, from here. I'm trying to think how to do this just the once. We've identified all of the empty bottles. So then, scoreboard. Object, well, scoreboard players set at e score empty bottle min equals 1, and they don't have a score in the scoreboard for their conversion, so score conversion equals 1. And let me see, we want conversion 100. There we go. So that should mean if we add in another little like item here to here, score conversion or score empty bottle. So, we should see one thing here, and that's not happening. Let me open up the scoreboard values here. Plop. Target selectors can be such a pain. Come on, where are you? So we're basically looking for things that don't have a score in conversion, basically. So, count, experience level, game mode, rotation, we can do that. Come on, where are you? Score, there we go. No more than a score. So you would think, then, that it would actually apply, but apparently not. That should be picking up the bottle, but it isn't right now, for some reason. What I can do instead is tag. That might work a bit better. But we'll see. So. Whoop, nope, not that part. I want to tag here. Scoreboard players. Tag. That. add, and we'll call it bottle. And from there, I can actually target every, like, instead of using an objective, I just need to tag it. Basically, it's pretty much a boolean. So, then, from here, we... Where have my commands gone? There they are. So we want tag equals bottle. Okay, and we set their value of conversion to 100. And let's see, score conversion min equals -1, we'll say. Doesn't need redstone, continually active. Tag bottle has been added, but let's also make that be that they don't have tag equals not bottle. So ones that aren't bottles already. Tag bottle added. Bingo. Okay, good. So with that, we can set their score and, like, add their tags and such. So execute that. We want to go to scoreboard players set. Conversion 100, and then in the next one, right after it, we want to set the tag. So, tag equals not bottle, score conversion min equals 1, add bottle, there. Okay, so, set the score of conversion to 100, tag bottle added, and it's only done that once. So scoreboard objectives set display sidebar conversion. Whoops, sidebarred. Getting a Shakespeare was too expensive, you see. Okay, and then we need this always active. So slash scoreboard players remove. At E, score conversion min equals 1, and it is conversion at 1. So now, it will keep ticking down, it'll actually go below 0. Well, yeah, it'll hit 0 right there, because it has managed to hit, it's managed to just hit exactly 0. So because it already has the tag, it doesn't get reset. Beautiful. So that's our little timer that tells us how long until it actually, like, works. Sidebar is like a side hoe. Is Undermine a vanilla server? It's yes, but it's heavily modified by command blocks and stuff. Okay. Now we actually only want to do that to ones that are in water. So with that, we want to be running this. So any ones that are in water, instead of just all of them, we just want to do that. And we want to players remove entities of type item within one block who have the tag bottle. So that way we know for certain that we only get those. So there we go. So now only applies to them. But I've apparently, oh yeah, mucked that up a little bit. So, bottled ones are now the only ones that do that. Perfect. And when they hit zero, what we want to do is remove their tag. Well, first we want to actually, like, change their item, which means using entity data, to replace it with this. So, change their item. And that is a little bit tricky, but we'll do it anyways. And that needs to be a chain. So entity data at E tag equals bottle score conversion equals 0. And we, well, entity data. 1.10 is easy to make structures and stuff. Ooh. Command blocks are amazing. Yeah. I'll get onto the structure blocks in no time, I promise. Okay, so we know the structure data of the actual like item. So let me show this part to you guys so that you can see it instead of just me looking off screen a whole ton. There we go. Okay. So here is the data structure of item entities, which is what we are trying to affect. So in the item slot, which is a compound tag, so it's the curly brackets, then we go to, ID, and change that to potion. And then the damage value we also need to change. So let's see, we need to change that to a value of 0, apparently. And then we, inside of the tag part is where all this stuff goes. So with that in mind, let me just chuck this down and we can use it as a marker where we got this right. So entity data at e type equals item, and there is no freaking way this is going to be short enough. Oh boy. Let's put that on impulse. Needs redstone. So slash entity data at e type equals item, and we want item ID to be Minecraft. What do we change this to? This is Minecraft potion. Okay. Minecraft potion. Okay, so that's one part done. Damage, we don't need to worry about too much. And then tag is where we stick all that big long piece of information. So there. So the hide flags and everything else. And we have one too many curly brackets there. So that should cause this to turn into a brew. No dice. Why not? Trying to figure this out. Okay. I'm going to be going on my break soon enough, so. Entity data at e type equals item. And we want item ID Minecraft potion. Okay, that worked at least. So then it's got to be to do with the tag part. I'm gonna have to break this down to a notepad, I think, because this is a long thing. Okay, so there's our target. And here's where things get complicated. Okay, hello, we're missing a bracket, that's why. Near as I can tell, we're missing a bracket anyways. There we go! Aha! So that is now an ethereal brew. Whoop. Hello, Fio Anime. So, this command we run on all the bottles. So, tag, we want score conversion equals 0. So, every like item that has that, we then do that too, and we want that to be on chain, always active. And then we remove their bottle tag. So scoreboard players. Let me switch this back to the game view. There we go. Look at me being all fancy. Blip. Right. So we want to remove the tag from it. Which I think is very straightforward. I've never actually used tags, but this is exactly what they're meant for. So scoreboard players tag at e type, well, tag, we want to make sure it already has the bottle tag, and score conversion equals 0. And remove bottle, so it no longer does anything to them, and put that on a chain as well. Okay, so now if we chuck a glass bottle in here, wait for it. So yeah, it's turned into an ethereal brew. If I do that and grab it before that happens, it's fine. Nothing happens, and of course it goes right back to 100. So basically, you have to wait a little bit for your given glass bottle to become an ethereal brew. And I also need to extend this a little bit so that it only happens in waters within like 5 blocks or so of the markers for getting spirit. But that is, phew, enough for the first hour. So I will be back in about 15 minutes. Hope you enjoy this already. So let me see, game rule, command block output false. So there we go. And just watch that. Hey, perfect. Phew. Anyways, I shall see you in about 15 minutes after my break. So when we left off, we were just about to make the creations of ethereal brew dependent upon it being near like one of those, because these are the things that actually like give us our actual spirit. So let me turn that back on so we can see them. I might turn that into a tag, but having it be on a scoreboard value allows me to have different versions of them. So a scoreboard value of 1 means it will only go up to 300, for example, whereas 2 is endless, and maybe at different rates as well. Oh, sorry, Bristol. So from there, we need execute from, let me see, execute from score water marker min equals 1. Execute on items within a radius r equals 5. So that is just looking for items, like for water bottles within that range, but it means it shouldn't get, yeah, it's got a value of conversion, but it's not actually going down, which is good. But I can make that like significantly more taut here. So with that, let's go execute at E score water marker min equals 1, blub, 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 blub. Execute on items within 5 blocks. Tag, don't have that. And then we can just get rid of this one entirely, because now we don't need it. Because now the only ones that are actually getting tagged as bottle at all are in fact the ones that are being checked. So yeah, nothing there. But if I go over here, now it's actually going down, and give it a mo. It is now ethereal brew. Lovely. Okay. So that means that the same place that you get your spirit is the same place that you can get your ethereal brews. At least in this regard. 40C. Jeez, I think it's like 30 around here. I'm also not entirely certain. Okay. I still need to figure out how to make this one work, though. Because even, like, just for demonstration here. Let's see. Summon villager. And let's make it silent, firstly. And no AI. And invulnerable, just for good measure. This would be the standard measure by which you make a marker entity, or at least it used to be. But it can get knocked around. Now, I guess I could use the knockback resistance, maybe. But the fact that I just like bump into these things gives you an idea that if it's in water, it'll get knocked away as well as soon as somebody breaks like a block near it. Now, you can't break the blocks near the actual spring because they're in spawn protection, but overwhere, like anywhere else, pretty much, you can do that. Can't interact with this guy much, but he's there anyway. So, yeah, that's a problem I need to fix. Here we go. It is also possible to make the armor stands basically unkillable as well, even in creative mode, but no, there's a problem. Okay, we've got this done now, I don't need that. So yeah, there we go. So that handles not falling into the void, this handles entering into ghost mode, as Bamboo called it, as well as restocking your ethereal brews and resupplying you with spirit. Good. And it doesn't work over here, so we can get rid of this now. So you have to be near one of the markers, which are giving off these particles, and you have to be in water for any of it to work, which is good. Hmm. So the next thing that I get to talk about is these. So what is this that's been hanging around here free for a little while now? This is the structure system. So if I just grab one of these, I'm in my Undermine skin at the moment. Okay, let's just set something up fresh. Right, so if I, let's see, data mode, save, and we want, let's just call it, box. Box A, why not? So we want to give that a size, let's say 5 by 5 by 5. Okay, so that gives us this nice little box. And into this box, I can put basically anything. I can even put, like, command blocks. So to that end, let's add a little structure in here. And you can tell this is definitely my, my Yog Dwarves playlist. Okay, so particle, flame, and what did I, how do I do this again? I can't remember. Slash particle. Right, yes, 111. And call it speed 1 and 50. Doesn't need redstone, constantly active. Okay, that's a bit much. There we go. So one block above it's doing all that. Let's make that. There we go. Little like fire. Let's reduce that to 0.25. There we go. Smaller fire. Okay. And let's add some more blocks to this so it looks nice. So, blip. And just make it a nice little thing. It's just this is purely just for demonstration. Let's see, let's grab some Nether Brick, because you can't go wrong with Nether Brick, literally ever. And pillars. So, grab that, put it there, look at there, and there. There we go. Very simple, very straightforward. Nothing particularly complex about this at all. Doesn't need to be that. That feel when you eat a hot curry. Ooh. I do love me a bit of curry. There we go, looks nice. Okay, so that's just a plain old test box, and let's just finish this up here with a little bit of grass. Okay, so we've got, that's surprisingly green considering I'm supposed to be in desert. Hmm. Oh, apparently I must be close enough to the Mushroom Island. Interesting. Okay, so we've got it set, we know where it is, so with that we just save it, we don't include the entities. Okay, now, if I come over to here, I set this to load mode, and we want box A. So, it's got it, load it, that's where it'll be, and I can offset this a bit, so put that to 0, put that to 1. There we go, just in front of it now. I can put that as far away as I like, which is great. I can even set the integrity and all sorts, but anyways, Let's hit load, and we can see even like the even the command block in there is working. So this is a perfect match. Now, here's where it gets really interesting. So we set that to load mode. Go box A again, and we want to set that to about 4, I think. Nope, a little bit more, like 6. There we go. Okay. So now, let's get ourselves some pressure plates. It's about there. And we're also going to need a little bit of sand and a cactus. Who can tell me where this is going? And then we just want to seal this up a little bit. Don't really need much. That'll do. What I'm about to do is definitely going to mess up the islands, but that's fine. I don't much mind. It's a bud? Nope, it is not a bud switch, which for those uninitiated is a block update detector. So, game rule, random tick speed to about 1,000, say 10,000. So that is now triggering those, and if I just set that back down to 10, then I can do something a little bit more sneaky down here. Get around that. I need a command block. I threw away one of the few things I actually need for this. Okay, grab that. Just need an impulse. So, let's see, slash kill at E, type equals item within about 2 blocks is probably enough. Needs redstone impulse. Okay. And now none of those are on. Good. Place that. Okay, so let me turn off the bounding box. So now we can't see anything. Let me break open a whole freaking ton of this. And then I'll dial up. So what's happening here is that whenever one of these pieces of cactus breaks off, and it is breaking off way too quickly for this, kill happy item. There. So whenever one of the pieces of cactus breaks off and lands on one of the pressure plates, it sends a redstone signal into the structure block, which causes this to automatically load back in the structure, which we'll see again in a moment. There we go. And then the command block automatically deletes the items around so the pressure plates can reset. So if I wanted to, this could be on a 5-minute reset just by taking out that command block. But yeah, this is random but regular structural regeneration. And it can be as simple as like this, it can be like, it can be even more simple, it could even be a lot more complicated. So I got this idea in very large part from Vex. V-E-C-H-Z, depending on where you're looking at, who is the creator of the Ultra Hostile series. And, oh yeah, one other thing I can do here, one really nice thing that this allows me to do, is if I save that, next time this loads up again, it's going to have the new version. There we go. So if I want to change these, like, I can actually do that in the world. Is pretty sweet. But yeah, so Vex uses this on his Ultra Hostile Online server, which is his Patreon server, not unlike Undermine is for me. And he uses this system with dungeons. So players can go in, they can build small structures, they can dig tunnels, and then gradually the different rooms will repair themselves of player influence. And I think that is a beautiful system. And the structure blocks just take it one step further, like one almost ridiculous step further, in fact. So This allows me to have the different islands repair, and it also allows me to build dungeons of my own in an extremely compact fashion. Compact and lag-free, because previously Vex's version works using the clone command. So just type that in. So this allows me to specify a bounding box and clone it somewhere else, or even move it wholesale, that kind of thing. Which is good, except that you have to have a clean copy of the actual like structure you're cloning in your world, which takes up a lot of space, especially on Ultra Hostile. So this, it's just a file. I can boot it up wherever I like, edit it wherever I like. I don't even have to have it in the world at all. It just has to be in the file system. So that now this now exists perfectly in the file system, no worries. And it's entirely like, it's the rate of regeneration is entirely based on the random tick speed. So if it's just normal, then it works, so hey, it'll work at the same speed as your regular cactus farm, basically. Don't like that evil grin you've got there? Aww. I can't make super hostile, let's be clear. I don't have, like, the slightest clue how Vex manages it, honestly. But, Redstone I can do. But, yeah. Oh, bye, Twangy. Catch you later. I don't know what random tick speed is set to usually. It's progressed for like 10. Let me take a look. Random tick speed. Zero will disable it, high numbers will increase it, default value is free. Okay. So yeah, if I just set that to the normal, or maybe even slightly higher for the server, I don't know, then whenever one of these little units goes off and manages to trigger that, a given small island, possibly probably a mining island or the like, or part of a dungeon will repair itself. So that is pretty sweet, I think. Now, I don't know what the upper limit is on the scale of these structure blocks. Let me see just a bit of stress testing here. So save, say, 5,000 and 50 by 5,000. This is probably, that's a pretty decent scale, I'd have said. That appears to have maxed out. Let's see. 32 by 32 by 32. Okay, that's still the size of a fairly large room, and I would say that's a fairly decent size for at least part of an island. So if I break the dungeons into 32 by 32 by 32 rooms and the like, then they could just repair over time. Now, there is another advantage to this as well, which is if I go over here, it says include entities. Stream immediately dies. Oh no! Everything's okay. Looks good to me, thankfully. Just gotta dig an air hole real fast. Oh, just watch us suffocate in a tunnel we just dug on a regen island, maybe. But yeah, I can, like, with the loading, if I go over to here, let's see, so integrity, let's say 0.25. So this currently is going very slowly, so let's set that back up really high. Yeah, okay. So integrity makes it go slowly. So piece by piece, it's just randomly picking blocks to change. And everything else it just leaves untouched. So slowly it'll repair. So that's one way that you could, like, not die horrifically. But that would rely upon me having a much more rapid kind of clock than this. And that's a little hard to do without changing the random tick speed, making things like getting cactus and growing crops and tree growth and grass spreading, that kind of thing, move a lot faster. So I will probably keep that to one. Or at least very high. So let's say 0.8. 0.8? Yeah, that's 0.8. Okay, so in a couple, that managed to restore. So yeah, as I was saying, something here allows you to actually include inside of the structure entities. So, for example, if I open this up and slash summon guardian, why not? Oh, I said, I came on peaceful at the moment. Slash summon guardian. You really don't like being in there, do you? Well, sucks to be you, because you're staying in there. If I can. There. Okay. So now, if I save this, the next time this loads up, it should include the guardian. No, apparently it hasn't. Okay. Probably because it's still on one. Oh, because I had that on. Yeah, okay. So, if we include the entities. So there we go. It's now summoned the guardian in as well. And that, unfortunately, has the downside that it does it every single time it loads in. Which is why if I was doing this, I'd probably only do it for, like, boss rooms. And I'd have an AND gate to make sure that they actually, to make sure that they actually only respawn if the boss is dead. So, when the boss dies, the place can regenerate and whatnot. And that would probably be a room that was on 1 instead of 0.8. But, yeah, that is really freaking cool. So let's just make a quick circuit for that, shall we? So, let's hop on over to here. Right. So, we... Let's see, how do I want to do this? We're gonna need a test for, so... Test for at E-type equals guardian. It's our most obvious one. Needs redstone impulse, yep. Or... Always active, repeat. That's also an option. So if we then get our comparator... There. Currently, no guardians around. But if I just summon another one, now we are detecting one. Good. I can detect them by score, I can detect them by tag, probably as boss. I'll probably have a tag for bosses. Or I can detect them by a bunch of other stuff. So then, we AND that together. So, blub, blub, and blub. And there. Okay. I'm trying to think. We need it to be on, which could be a lot simpler, actually, I think of it. So, hang on a second. I can make this much smaller. So... Let's see. If that detects nothing, and this does detect something, then that means I need, like here, and there. We need an OR, basically. So let's just get that set, and have our impulse here to just kill off nearby entities, so type item r equals 2. And we get ourselves our structure block onto load mode, which currently doesn't have anything set to it, but it's fine. And a bit of cactus. And get ourselves the actual... Whoop. You grew quickly. There. They grow up so fast. Okay. That was a mistake. There. Okay, that should do the job. Ok, Okay, so any four of those triggering causes this. And... look. Okay. So, if we are detecting... actually, we want to change that out, so... slash fill 2, 2, 2, and... minus 2, no, minus 2. Occasionally I make mistakes like this that would require me to rebuild something annoyingly, so let's say I want to just have stone, 0, replace structure block. Oh, because I missed a negative. There we go. So then we would trigger that. Okay. And just build this out a little bit, because you can see they can fall out a little bit. Or go up as well. Which is why this would probably be a fully enclosed thing. What I love about these, though, is you can stack them. So... okay, so we are currently detecting no known and no known entity here. And let me just save that. There we go, so that's fine. Right. So with that, we need... let's just make a little cage. That makes the most sense to me. So, 0, 1, 5... and structure size, we'll go back to the 5s, because why not? Okay, so that's our little spot to build. And let's build, like, a room from a dungeon, say. So we want... whoop, not the monster eggs. Monster eggs are a pain. But in this kind of dungeon, I can totally employ them. That's entirely viable. That's entirely viable. In this. And an iron door, because why not? Anything that keeps them wandering out of the zone, more or less. So yeah, basically, I'll have, like, entities turned off, and I'll have, like, mob spawners for most areas, and then every so often I'll have something else. So let's see. Difficulty 2. Summon a pig zombie. Okay, you want to be looking for a pig zombie instead of guardian now. And let's say that as boss 1. Include entities. Save. Okay. So now, you want load mode. Boss 1, and load, and let's just get rid of that so I can actually position this, and let's see, let's move this down 1, negative 4, I think that'll be, nope, quite a bit more than that, negative 9, nope, getting close though, negative 8, and shift it about 2 that way. Okay. So now, include entities. And let's actually shuffle this back about 6. Nope, a little bit too far. Negative 4. There we go. Okay. So currently, there are 2 zombie pigmen in here, because I accidentally just triggered that. So, slash kill at e type equals pig zombie. And then the next time that that triggers, we now have a new pig zombie. Hi there, and I can give him all the data I like, I can make him work purely as a boss in any fashion I want. I can have the command blocks as part of this structure. Those can't be destroyed, but that's something to bear in mind. And now because this is detecting that that there is already a pig zombie, it knows we don't need to spawn a new one. Beautiful. So, yeah, that's how I would do areas that had actual entities in them. Yeah, so the respawning of the bosses is as tied to the random tick speed as everything else. Pretty nice. So we can have boss chambers respawning with the bosses. We can have like rooms. We can have entire islands respawning. Obviously, something this massive is way too unreasonable. Like, this is... I don't even know how big this is. Let's take a look, shall we? So let me open up. Let's see, where's my MC edit gone? Okay, if I just open this up, which will take me a hot minute. We can see just how big these islands are. Like, for scale reference, if nothing else. So let's open 1.1 testing, and control I, I think it is, nope. No, I don't want to change that, that's reformatting. Okay, so complete islands, just take a look at the Mesa one. So the Mesa one is pretty huge. If I got a chunk view, this will be a lot easier to work out. So there's the islands currently. And this is how big one of them is. I can rotate them, I can nudge them around wherever I like. This is what MC Edit looks like right now. It has changed a lot over the years. So if I just plunk that right there, it'll tell me exactly how big this is. Currently I have 8 island molds, and I'm planning on having about 16 islands. So there we go, that is 272 wide, 256 long, and 60 tall. So having those be repaired is horrifically unreasonable. But restoring different small rooms inside of a dungeon, restoring like at least small parts of a island that is meant to be harvested, perfectly reasonable. So I think that's what I'll end up doing. Did I just hear Elemental's fans were into life? No. I don't think so, although it's getting somewhat, like, warm in here. So yeah, that's, like, the scale. If people think that they're not going to have enough room to play around on, oh boy, do I have good news. And there'll be 16 of those. Now, you won't be able to access all 16 initially, because the world border will be so small, you'll have access to maybe 3 of them. And as you, like, kill off the bosses, once per boss, the bosses of course respawn, then we get to actually, like, encounter- we get to expand and encounter different biome islands and such. Which means we don't have to run across the surface at night, freeing the monsters that for some reason don't care about light anymore, don't murder us to get to, like, a jungle. All pretty sweet, I think. Can imagine the tiny houses. Oh? I don't know if they'll be tiny. I mean, you can have some pretty large houses on here without really encroaching upon anyone else. Plunk down all the torches on the big islands. The surface runs are fun, but it seems a bit severe, especially for, like, members that aren't necessarily magnificent at, combat and such. Yeah, it wasn't just night, it was always, it was all the time. That was the thing that was the weird thing that we discovered by sheer virtue of playing Undermine, is when you're at the build limit, like when you're at block level 256, I think it was, the lighting engine breaks. So consequently, the mobs and monsters and stuff that only spawn at night otherwise spawn day wide, 24/7. It's kind of crazy. So yeah, that is my plan with the respawning islands that are used for gathering resources and other supplies and such. And that is my plan for the actual, like, construction zones where players build bases and such. And this is my plan as it currently stands. Let's say I need to come up with some way to make an entity not move in water. That is the hard part. Let me see if I can... I'll bring up, like, my little, summon helper, and we'll see what happens if we set, like, speed down to zero as well as knockback resist to 100, because that should mean that we have an entity that is entirely impervious. But we'll see. So let's see. Villager. Iron golems are usually my go-to, but I prefer them for more standing things. Now, a point of note, when you are actually developing stuff like this, effects versus attributes. There are two, like, ways that you can alter an entity, generically. So there's status effects, which is things like giving them strength, things like giving them speed, that kind of thing. And there are attributes, which are innate qualities, like maximum health, like knockback resistance, that kind of thing, attack damage. You can modify both when you're summoning an entity, but what is worth noting is that effects can be given a massive duration, such that, at least in a single player playthrough, they are functionally endless. But if you're on a server that is loaded the whole time, and they're in, say, the spawn chunks, which are always loaded all the time, that does actually wear out eventually. Like, give it a week, maybe, but... So, it is worth remembering. If you're doing that kind of thing, you want to make sure that they only have under certain circumstances. Let's turn yours silent as well, and no AI. Okay. Whoop. Hello.
Oh, I was going to go to Sainsbury's after my shower, but
yeah, you have like 9 minutes. Does moving faster affect the eggs more, or...?
No, it doesn't. And also, I don't think I'd get there in time. It's not really polite to show up to a shop like 5 minutes before it closes.
Yeah.
Even if it is to get, like, ice cream and food.
Yeah, I think you'll have to wait till tomorrow. Okay. Also, the chat says hi.
Hi.
Thank you. Ah, okay. So here we have... Nope. Even with 100% knockback resistance, you can still nudge them around. Let's change that to an armor stand and see if that changes it at all. Okay, we can't nudge this around. That's progress. So, oop. Okay, Night Bristol. Can't you no AI tag an entity so it doesn't move? Yes, so it doesn't move being the operative word. It doesn't move. Yep.
I can't find my bag, so I'm borrowing yours.
Oh, okay, I thought you weren't going anywhere. Never mind, they've gone already. Okay. But it can still be moved. Case in point. No AI on this guy, still moved. But let me just kind of do something devilish. Bye. Okay, so you're... I can make you a... The only reason I can break that thing is because I'm actually, like, in creative mode. Okay, let's get you there. Can you be moved? Yes. So yeah, that is the problem. Since these entities are intended to be in water, I have to be incredibly, careful about which entity and whether or not it can be moved by water. So that is the problem. Now, even guardians are moved by water. So even, like, there is, to my knowledge, no entity I can use that is perfectly immune to water. So I'm not really 100% certain how I can resolve that. Like, that is as close to unmovable as I can do. But because it has to stand in water, I have to be very careful. Now, if I could find an entity that wasn't, like, ever pushed by water, that would be perfect. But I don't think there is such a creature. Let's see, water current. Water with a current pushes mobs at a speed of about 1.39 meters per second or 25 blocks every 18 seconds. So it would seem that it affects all entities, no matter what. Oh dear, I have a protection plug and grant no one the permission to edit the area to protect the armor stand, or only admins. Must it be an entity? Like, how about tile entities? Tile entities are not searchable. So let me see if I get a furnace. So test for at E type equals furnace. Entity type furnace is not valid. Test for at E doesn't pick up anything, or else we'd be seeing the output. Game roll. Log admin commands true. Not picking up anything, interestingly enough. Oh, that admin. There we go. If I do command log output, it's going to be very irritating. A zombie. Where are we getting that zombie? Slash kill at E type equals zombie. Why are we somehow detecting a zombie? Where is there a zombie? Must be inside the islands. Okay, so yeah, we got a ton of stuff here. This is mostly effects playing. But we are not likely. Yeah, we can't find any, like, furnaces. So tile entities can't be, like, affected by this. Game rule and block output false. Blah. Shut up. Right. Minecraft, why you're coding like this? What about the Ender Dragon health orbs? Oh, you mean the Ender Crystals. I think, believe it or not, those can be, like, pushed by Ender to a high point. So let me see, Ender Crystal. Blub, blub, blub. So, yeah, there it is. It's not being pushed. That might do the trick. In which case, it'll be blooming obvious. Like, it'll be very blooming obvious exactly where these things are. Because I can't make them invisible forever. Although, I guess if I have them, like, marked, then I can use that instead. Just to give them the effect every time. Fun fact, you used to be able to stick an Ender Crystal in a boat and just boat about with them. Yeesh. Put it in a cave in a barrier block box and expand the affected area to reach. Harder to do. Let's see. Fill. 8. Where? Actually, no. Okay. And make that 2, actually. We got 1 here. -8. -8. Sand, stone, 0, replace air. And have another world where it is literally just there's a level of barrier blocks on. Kill at a type equals item. There we go. Easy home cleaning using command blocks. Or just bedrock around the pool so it can't be forced to flow, like the bottom of the pool. That's a bit more complicated, honestly. So, let me see. If I get rid of you for a second. And let's see. Let's summon an invulnerable. So we want to summon that invulnerable 1B. Okay, that looks pretty decent actually. And scoreboard players set at E type equals ender crystal. R equals 2, doesn't really matter too much. Water marker 1. Okay, so I think this is. Yeah, it's looking for 1. I'm trying to think if it's actually like registering. Scoreboard objectives. Oh, time for a second break. Okay. I will catch you all in 15 minutes then when we see if this has worked out. Anyways, catch you then. In the interim, I did a bit of testing, and there does appear to be a limitation to using the ender crystals. So yes, it does appear as though I can make them indestructible. So, for example, let me just grab a sword and a bow and arrow. And yep, blip. So then, game mode 0. So, if I hit him with my fists, not a thing. Hit him with a sword, not a thing. Shoot him with an arrow, also not a thing. No chance. So, can definitely make them not explode. But you see these? This is from me trying to find it. So, let's see. Make it invisible. Or make all ender crystals invisible. Cannot be found. Can't make them glow. Can't make them invisible. So if I wanted to use these for my markers, I pretty much need to have them visible. Which isn't too bad, but, I don't know. I see issues with that. I see issues. But it's an idea. It is an idea. And for those wondering, yes indeed, hitting them whilst they're in the water, like the whilst they're in water that makes sure they don't do anything. So I'm not really terribly certain what to do here. You know, what about poor lying? What happened to me? Eh? Am I okay? Am I gonna be alright? Say it ain't so. Still wanna do a little bit more testing to make absolutely certain that these can't be pushed. I presume they can't be. But it's worth checking out. I imagine if you could push them, they would probably be very interesting in, like, the end. I know people have captured them before and moved them around, but I admit I don't know how. Ah, yes. You cannot find the perfect entity. God, that sounds like a Dragon Ball Z plot. The perfect entity. Cell. Okay. Let's summon it. Where are you? Summon an invulnerable ender crystal. There we go. Nice and on the floor like. Can't interact with it. Good. Definitely can't move it. And now I can't put a bucket down there, so I gotta use another one to just erase the water. Okay, so yes, it looks indeed as though they can't be, like, moved around. Which is still pretty handy. Minecarts definitely can be. And also I need to, like, summon. So let me see. Summon entity minecart. Minecraft. Summon entity minecraft. Just notch turns up. Unable to summon. Is it mind count writable? I'm trying to remember how you do this. There we go. These guys do move. He's moving very slowly, but he is moving. So, yeah. Talking to the kidnapping queen. Pistons, minecarts, and boats, my friend. A little bit. But yeah, I think Ender Crystals will do the job, at least. So, let's bring one in. So we want just invulnerable. Let's have a custom name, because why not? Spirit Water. Why not? Doesn't need to be silent, doesn't need an AI, just needs to be invulnerable. So there it is. We can't actually see the name, but that's fine, really. If I wanted to add the name, there's any multitude of ways I can do that. And then scoreboard players set at E type equals Ender Crystal Water Marker 1. And now we've got our splashes. Good. And I'm actually going to turn this down a little bit. I don't need to, because it only targets players that are in water anyway. So it doesn't actually matter if the water is too short, because either way you had to be in water. So, yeah. Not too long ago, my alchemist made a reference to being a golden being. I had to spend like 10 minutes explaining the alchemical theory that gold was the perfect material. Wow. Okay. So, with that, we can now make our bottles. So give that a little moment, and it'll be topped up to be an ethereal brew. Yep. And we can also regain spirit, so if I go to game mode 0, and try to fall into the void. I've just remembered that I did not turn those back on. I didn't turn all these back on, it's why that happened. Because I turned them off whilst we had the things going. Good. No, that actually does need redstone. Okay, well, that happened to happen. That, of course, had to happen eventually. So we drop down here. I'm not in game mode 0. Jeez, I'm flipping everything here. Give it a moment. Okay. Game mode 0. There we go. Now I'm losing spirit. Good. If I go into here, spirit is regaining. Okay. So, with that, I am actually like, that is the spirit system set. I think. I obviously want to put a little name here or something, but In fact, which one is this that does that? It's fine, I didn't need those items anyways. Whoops, mind your step, there we go. Okay, so we grab one of these, we get ourselves an anvil, which I think is under decoration. Yes, there we go. Give it a name. In fact, let's just call it lying, because why not? And yes, it was this one, okay. So that should now mean that it has the name lying whenever I fall into the void. Emphasis on should. Let's take a look. Yes, lying whispers to you. Whoops, find your step. Perfect. So yes, rolling natural ones. Well, it is getting late, so, you know, there's that. But if I wait here, I can regain some spirit. Now does that... Let's see... Yeah, so that's a slight problem. Trying to think. 275, we just had 25? That'll get to... nice round 300. Okay. And let me get brew. Brew is like by far the easiest thing to do. Whoop. Studied old alchemical theory. Hmm. The alchemy I prefer is in potions and poultices and bombs and such. Yeah. Okay. Just wait around a little bit. It'll give me the alert to let me know when I'm about to drop back out. I should actually have... I should rename that as well. But okay. Right. No spirit at all. That's the next thing we need to do, actually, is the, my brain's going a little bit. The skulls, basically. I need to do the skulls. So yes, just happily regaining some spirit. Now, I'd be interesting if you could kill, like, someone who had some spirit and get some more, but on the other hand, I don't necessarily want to encourage PvP, because there's a lot of people on the Undermine server that aren't necessarily great, like, at PvP or particularly favorable of it, like, they don't enjoy it. So it wouldn't make terribly much sense to mechanically encourage PvP like that. Yeah, and if you don't have, like, enough spirit, it will not actually stop you from going down there. So, let me see. Get back into game mode 1. Right. So, in order to create our skulls of embodiment, if you want to call them that, how about only gaining PvP spirit in an arena? You definitely get some spirit for killing off a boss. I think that much is definite. So that'll be something like detect the boss and have like an entity nearby, and if that stops being the if we stop detecting the boss, then we issue out a like spirit gift to the room. But anyways, let's get our anti-spirits. Anti-spirits, that's a weird phrase. Okay. So these can be evil. I'm going to say that right now. Because you will soon materialize, find a safe place to stand. That absolutely can... That is meant to be like, oh, if you're over the void now, or you're like in a solid object, now would be a good time to find someone, like somewhere to stand that's safe. But these absolutely won't. So anyways, we need to tag some items here. So we want to scoreboard players tag at e type equals item add anti-skull, because why not? And we want item ID, we're just going to say skull for the moment. So that should let us know where all the skulls are. And then we just want to set their entity data so their age is 0. At e tag equals anti skull age 0. Okay, so if I then get myself a skull, I've still got my my tomb textures on from Dungeon Maker. Okay, scrap that. Let's see. Test for at e type equals item. Item. Oh, what if it's like, whatever it requires, I add the Minecraft part. Minecraft skull. Okay, so test for at e type equals item. Item ID Minecraft skull tile cactus did not meet the required structure. Okay, so that means it should have detected that, but I don't see this going down. Okay. How do you not know who DJ Khaled is? He is lovely. I have no clue. Could killing a boss increase your maximum spirit cap? There isn't a cap to it, like, right now, at all. So, not really sure. Also, misclick, sorry. Let's see. Yeah, there is no, like, actual upper limit to your spirit cap, because the more, like, functionally, the amount of spirit you have determines how far away you can go, by sheer, like, spectator mode, without having somebody already there to teleport to, which is easier. Having a cap makes them limited, which goes somewhat is somewhat antithetical. So, let me see, where am I getting our items? Like, that's what I'm looking at. Good. So, we add the score to conversion. Where did I put this? Ah, here we are. So, don't have the bottle, do have the score. Add bottle. Okay. Ready and aim before fire. Yeah, basically. Now, Swift MJ there was a bot at best. Okay. Let's see, I want... functionally this one. Okay. So... but I also need to do that. That's what I want. Okay. Now that is if they're in water, so that's not as helpful. Execute. And the tag is anti-skull. Don't need to detect anything. So... we just need the scoreboard section, actually. So, type item. Add anti-skull. Tag. Always active repeat. And are we not detecting any of them? Is that the question here? So, slash test 4 at E. Tag equals anti-skull. Not finding anything, apparently. Slash tp at e tag equals anti-skull to me. We are apparently not finding that skull, interestingly enough. Oh, because this is glass bottles, that makes no sense. Minecraft skull. Skullboard players. Am I, like, doing this weird? Let's have a look around. Where is tag? Come on. Data tags, type, orientation, name, game mode, experience level, count. Tag, there we are. That's what I'm looking for. Right, so it's scoreboard players, tag, add, tag name, okay. Why is this not working then? Presumably that's because this isn't working somehow. So let's just do that. Should be going just fine here. Unconditional, repeat, always active. Hmm. this magic to not work? That is my question here. Wow. Wow. Item ID, Minecraft, skull. Okay, now it works. Who knows why? Okay, so instead of that, we want to tag. Type equals item that does not already have the anti-skull marker. Add anti-skull. And just so we know where these are, we want that. But instead of splash, we'll use smoke. So tag equals anti-skull. There we go. Okay, getting somewhere. And entity data at e tag equals anti skull age 0. So slash entity data at e tag equals anti skull. Just make sure I got the right thing here. Motion, health, invulnerable, air, on ground, dimension. Cooldown, thrower. age. There we go. Now we'll note that's not changing, which is perfect. That's exactly what we want. Because that is responsible for items that, like, despawn, basically. So we see there it's a 50, 67, so yeah, that's working just fine. So that means that that skull will never despawn, which is exactly what we want to see. Now, let's make these particles a bit tighter in. And something else. I'm spawning five particles here. So. Okay. There we go, that's a bit better. And we want to be only attaching that to Wither Skulls. Dragon Heads would be interesting. I think we just want the data value of 1 then. So, damage 1. So now it shouldn't affect that, but it should affect Wither Skulls. And it is not. Okay, I have gotten something wrong here. Let's see. Take a look here. So, count damage 0s. There we go. Okay. So that is a Wither Skull that is not going to be causing any troubles for right now, because we haven't actually made it do anything. So, what we want to do is set everybody within range of that who is in their spirited mode, who's in spectator mode, to a special value. And from there we can tell them, oh no, there's an anti-skull. Now the question is, do I shunt them out of being in spectator mode immediately, or do I just drain their spirit inordinately quickly? Which means they should still get the alert, but they'll still be able to, like, so they'll still be able to find safe ground. Or do I just want this to be stay away? Like, one thing I can, I think, do. So slash effect at E tag equals anti skull. Let me see, 24. No, it looks like I can't affect them. Let's try it out here. So anti tag equals anti skull. 24, 1, 1. Cannot find them. Ah, just so I know.
Oh, Jesus, it's warm in here.
Yeah, I know. Not much I can do about that. Can I help you? Hi.
Hello.
This is really uncomfortable.
I apologize.
Keep your spirit, but immediately back to survival. Well, I suppose either way you are going to fall. If you do fall into the void, you're not going to die because of the other command blocks that are set up, so that is something to consider. But you might suffocate inside of a solid wall is the other possibility.
I'm kind of hungry.
Oh? You are very cool.
Well, yeah, that's because I've been trying to cool off for, like, the past half hour. Your screen is doing the thing again.
I'm aware.
Mm, 68% humidity.
Yeah. How are we meant to get back to survival mode without the skulls? Just let the spirit run out, and then how do we get back to the spring without the spirit? Well, Hey. Well, yes, the anti-skulls are meant to be like the main way that you can the main way that you get out of being in spirit mode. But when you run out of spirit, you lose some spirit if you fall into the void, if you have some. But you still get teleported regardless. It's just sort of a penalty if you have a bunch of spirit and fall into the void, but it doesn't stop when you have none. So, if you want to get back to the spring, just jump into the void when you're out of spirit. It is also worth noting that there are some like special locations that you can't spirit into. So, for example, you cannot use spirit to bypass an entire dungeon.
Hi.
Hi. The exception being when the boss is dead, but that's obvious, I would have said.
Yeah, apparently it's going to be thundering light tonight.
Oh dear.
Yeah, that's going to be fun.
Hmm.
I'm being sarcastic, for those who can't tell.
Yeah, you don't like having... You don't like those at all. I'm trying to think of how I could, like... If you can see this for a wall, it'll help a lot with, like, not getting stuck in the wall. So...
Yes, 68% humidity and it's 23 degrees Celsius. In the middle of the goddamn night.
Hmm. Oh, also, I should stress, this will not just be get a wither skull and dump it on the ground, because that would be dangerous in the nether, if nothing else. It is, like, going to be a special one. But for now, I'm just using this for testing. The rain will help. Thunder is horrid, but the rain will help. Hmm. With the humidity, or...?
With the heat.
I guess. That's it. So we'll open the door in here, but... Hmm. So, Fez, if you would like to venture an opinion.
Yeah?
This is the thing that shunts you out of spectator mode.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning you either get land on solid terrain, get suffocated, or fall into the void.
Uh-huh.
Which is better, immediate, like, shunting, or rapid drain of the thing that keeps you into spectator mode?
I think rapid draining.
Hmm. So, in that case, we've established that we can't actually do anything. So, execute at E, tag equals anti-skull.
Jesus Christ, Runny, where do you live?
Who knows?
Do you live in, like, the desert? Actually, I have heard it's been really hot in Israel lately.
Oh?
Yikes.
Yeesh.
My condolences.
Mm. Okay, so if I have that correct, then if I enter... I think how it does make... just drink that. Okay, so if I enter here...
The highest temperature I've ever experienced was, like, just upwards of 35 degrees.
Player has joined the game.
Oh, hello, Raoul 1217.
That was painful.
Hmm?
You know that one night when it got up to, like, 35 degrees when I was down in London?
Oh, yeah.
For the Area 11 concert.
Hmm.
Like, they had to do, like, a half-hour break right after the opening act, just so that people could get out and cool down a bit. Because otherwise it would have posed a serious health risk.
Yeah.
It was fun, but it was goddamn... It was an oven in there.
Hmm.
Yes, use Celsius. It is the superior measurement. Anyways, I'll let you get on with your thing.
Hmm.
And... I don't know, maybe find a snack.
Sounds good.
And perhaps even play a bit of Overwatch.
Yay! Catch later.
Uh-huh.
Let me see, where's my thing that shuts you out? Score of spiriting. Game modes are everyone who's gone to spirit. Okay. Where is the warning put in? That's the thing I need to remember. Spirited score of 60. Okay. So if we set that to 60 instead of that. So everybody that is spiriting, who is in spectator mode and has at least 60, is within 15 blocks of an anti-skull. Let's crank that up all the way to 10 just so we know for sure that we're being affected by it. So if I... So fairly regular. And oh boy, yeah, that's going low quickly. I think that went by so quickly that the thing didn't even register to warn me. Which is neat, but oh boy. So basically, if you get near to one of these, it will rapidly drain your, like, spirit. Which is good, because that's what we're looking for in this particular context. Scoreboard players set at P spirited 300. Okay. So yeah, and then it stops when you've got less than 60. So you can actually see the warning and find somewhere to stand. So good. But problem. This doesn't get you out directly. So we need to have some other item that has a much shorter range, but which does actually shunt you out of spirit entirely. So that is the anti-skull. That is the thing that you use to ensure that your area is warded away from people who are in spirit, but still allows you to actually spirit. So that's a drain skull, if you will. I still think it's valuable enough, like reasonable, to have somewhere that just straight up shuts you out. Yeah, there's a spawn for the ender crystal. So what do we want to use for that? A creeper skull, maybe? Creeper skull make a degree of sense. So cool, so hot. Ideally something like you could reasonably otherwise get. A beacon, a Neverstar maybe? Neverstars are always nice. Let's go with that. Okay. So, same kind of idea. Neverstar. Don't need to worry about damage because there's no such real thing here. So items that don't have the anti-star, we give to anti-star. Make sure they don't go away. Provide particles. In this case, we'll do magic crit, which is honestly one of my favorite particles in Minecraft. Unconditional, repeat, always active. It's doing the thing again. Why is it doing the thing again? There we go. Okay. So now this looks a lot more obvious. In theory, I could also have been struck by lightning, which would be an interesting one. I'm just gonna move those particles to go a little further up. I think I'll do the same with the anti-skulls. So that's when you want to deter entry, like, but you don't want to kill somebody. And this is when you straight up want to risk killing someone because you don't want them nearby. Basically, that's what is going on here. Really, I already have my... Oh, yeah. Okay, so the effect when you're here, when you're doing that, is execute tag anti-star all players set within 5 blocks who are currently spiriting. We want to set their game mode, basically. So, at A, R equals 5, M equals 3. So, I don't have any spirit right now, let me set that. Okay. So now, spiriting, not spiriting, and also prevents my spirit from currently prevents my spirit from going down while I'm here at least. But if I go away, I go back into spirit, which is, I'm not sure, is that what we'd like to be seeing? That's technically a pause point more than anything else, which I guess makes it useful, but I don't know. Let's add a number. Lying on the floor for now makes my rib feel squished in. Yeah, that'll happen. Okay. And scoreboard set. Score spiriting min equals 1. I'll probably change that to a tag. So it's a bit clearer, so I don't have to use scores, because there's no difference, it's a boolean status. To spiriting 0, which means you will not get put back into your state. So, yeah, there we go. So that shuts you right out of being in your spirited state, and also has the effect that, like, that also has the distinctive effect that it won't despawn either, so it stays there forever. Pretty sweet. Cat in lap. Oh no. Blip. Be interesting if I added the draining effect to anybody wearing one of these. That'd be interesting. An idea, perhaps. So one of them drains your spirits, but can be fairly malign. The other one can straight up murder you by virtue of getting you stuck in a wall. So just a matter of how malicious you feel, like how painful do you want it to be for people to be visiting your area. So, for example, there will probably be a Neverstar-like effect. Actually, no, there'll just be a straight teleport back to spawn, I think. If people decide to bug me whilst I'm busy on the server and such. Because I'm probably going to be doing a lot of stuff just in creative mode, building stuff, on this new version of the map. Phew. So I may just have an admin-like option there. So let me see, what else am I missing? Well, I just need to, like, set these, so... Game mode 1. Okay. Let's see, tag. And I need to see chunk format, okay. Or is it player dat? I think it's player dat. Kind of structure. So we want a lore text value. Lore is the best one to use for this because you can't add it in vanilla. So lore is just a list, and the first thing that we want is anti-star. What's a good description for this? Shunts nearby spirits into the material realm, why not? So slash give at p never star 1 0 more. Actually, I want to display more shunts nearby spirits into the material realm. So now we got that little bit of lore text, and now it ain't working. Probably because I got this wrong somewhere. Tag display. Ah, yes, we just got lore, no display here. Okay, let's take a look, because I've probably messed this up somewhere. Oh yeah, it is almost break time. Yeah. One moment. Okay, that's good. That's fine. That's fine. Ha! Missed a semicolon. There we go. So, special Never Stars only. And with that, I will be back in 15 minutes. Okay, so one huge advantage of using items in this fashion instead of placed blocks is that I can make a circuit like this. So, I literally froze together in like 5 seconds or so. If this breaks, then we know why. Push one button, out comes the anti-skull. Push the other button, anti-skull goes away into there. So, this is a toggle system for an anti-spectator kind of area, which I love that things like this are possible. It's a very simple thing, but that is just really cool. Oh, also, yeah, I added, like, descriptions to both of them, so shunts and drains. In fact, we could even make it a 50-50. So, we've got drain, shunt, and they work perfectly because they're just checking for lore text. Pretty sweet, I think. But yeah, that's like something that you can do with a little bit of redstone savvy. What's an anti-spectator? Okay, how do I explain this really quickly? This score over here is like a power bar, basically. If I drink one of these ethereal brews, I go into spectator mode until that power on the side there runs out, which it very quickly will, actually. So, about 60 will give me a warning. Yep, find a safe place to stand. And I'm out. These, let's see. This one immediately shunts you back into survival mode. This one very rapidly drains your bar. So, that's what those are. And that's just part of a special mechanic that's going to be in the next Undermine map, because it's a Skylands, so being able to fly to at least some degree is highly advantageous. Let me see. Other things that I've worked out are conditional penalties if you fall into the void. So if you have more than a certain amount of spirit, like power bar, it will drain it a little bit. But it will still, either way, stop you from falling into the void. So, lying whispers to you, whoops, mind your step. And then I also talked about these, which are self-repairing systems and conditionally repairing systems for boss rooms and such. So, we can have islands and various parts of dungeons repair over time, in case players have done something to them, like try to break them or break into them, that kind of thing. The only other thing I think I want is like an unobtainable Never Star here, so you cannot possibly fly through an area. But that's gonna be just by going by boss tags, I think. Follow up question: why are you making a second Undermine map? Because the current one is very old. It's about a year old, going on almost exactly a year, in fact. And it's kind of outdated. And the server is dying slightly with the map, and I'd like to try out something new. So having a second map is better than just starting the old one over again. And it's great to, like, Undermine started out in part because I wanted to try playing Minecraft in a way that people hadn't done before, especially on a server. So it's nice to, like, boot up a new map and do something... never do the same thing twice, as I usually say. So a Skylands map is, like, a great idea, I think. Because I don't know of any server that's ever had a Skylands, let alone a Skylands with a spirit system that allows you to, like... that allows you to fly in spectator mode. But yes, those items might be dungeon loot, or they might be something you can buy, maybe with spirit, maybe there was something you can make, I could work that out. But those are utilities for the most part. And it'll have a boss tag for entities so that you can... because you can actually put tags inside of entity edits, so perfect. So then I can have bosses respawn, and then I can automatically shunt people out of spectator mode that are too close to them, so you have to go through the dungeon when the boss respawns. Just recharging my spirit here. Technically, Mineplex is on a Skylands map, but it's not the same since the point isn't building or surviving, but playing minigames. Yes, this is true. And the other, like, the one other thing is just making these ethereal brews. You just chuck them into water for a little bit near one of these crystals. And then you'll get one. Try not to stack them, because I'm pretty sure it will actually break them. But let's take a look. So let's chuck 32 in. I'm actually not sure how this is going to treat the count. Okay, so it is definitely better to brew them en masse, because it's faster. But on the other hand, they only take one per slot because of the entity data. Well, now I know. So let's just get rid of those. Okay. So, yeah, there you go. Zero penalty of falling off the islands, you don't die, a dragon swoops in, grabs you, and pops you back at spawn. Yeah. Which is part of, like, the anti-vertigo protection. Because I don't want it to be that you can't lose your items. Like, Minecraft has that as one of its key elements. You die, your items drop, they can time out, despawn, but that's it. But, on the other hand, falling into the void, you have no capacity to, like, retrieve your items, which is a bit sucky, and I know people don't like that. So having a capacity to fall into the void and actually not only survive, but retain your items, pretty nice. And I lost 50 spirit there, you saw. So, yay. Pretty nice. Yeah, there are 16 islands, Sakura, and they're all pretty huge, so... Definitely do not claim ownership of one entire island. I would say a conglomerate of maybe at least four, as an absolute minimum, can claim an entire island, but there's nothing to protect it. Minecraft update idea, create and save custom blocks and items with custom properties and spawning realms and heights, thereby making item and block creation immediately accessible with the game. That'd be an interesting one. But that's going into, like, the modding system. So let's see, that's... Okay, so that is the immediate shunt. So let's give this a shot. That has a much shorter range. And I'm immediately out. Okay. Yeah, that has a much shorter range than the, My brain has gone completely. Wow. Than the drain. The drain has a much larger range. But in theory, like, the anti-star, like the Never Star here, can actually be useful in that it won't drain you. If you know where it is, it's basically a landing point. So that's something. Okay, so now I've got 232. If we go back in... Okay, we can see it's draining at a regular pace, and now it's going... It was going even faster there until it knocked me a bit below. Game mode 1. I might keep Total Spirit on the side so people can always see it. That's an idea. Does this area need a constant chunk loader? Yeah, this will be in spawn chunks. And anything else that's regional will just be in its own region, so you have to be there anyways. So, there's that. So, like, the boss parts will be in, like, their own chunks with the actual dungeon they're associated to, because these are really small. I don't need a particularly large bedrock box for these. Like, it's great. And then a lot of things are remote. So, for example, this has a scoreboard value, and that allows me to apply anything, like, that I have over here to any of these anywhere in the world. And the same with these, because these are just, like, items that I can recognize that can't be manually crafted, and as long as they're loaded, and as long as spawn is loaded, they get their effects. So, pretty handy, I think. Phew. And then these will probably be in the same chunks as the dungeon they're associated with as well. Because I don't need, like, thanks to the structure blocks, I don't actually need any kind of, like, clone. I don't need any base, because they're just already here. They're already stored in the world, which is lovely. I am probably going to be putting up this actual, like, stream as a little video on my channel a little later, but we'll see. Because I don't know about the actual, like, quality here. Just heard a shriek from out front. Oh dear. Yeah, for some reason, possibly because I call it spirits, I keep going to Dark Souls when I try to come up with names for stuff with this idea. Have I tried to further condense the command blocks with multifunctions? Would doing so slow with the process? Define multifunctions. But yeah, I think I originally called the ethereal brew the brew of hollowing, and I had an idea that you could light bonfires with some spirit or whatever, and that would be like where you set your spawn to or something, or maybe they'd just be like bonfires that automatically set your spawn or something. Oh, bye, Torun. Enjoy. Yeah, define multifunctions for me, Michael, because I do not follow. And I'm just getting the hang of these as well, so please. Yeah, I could probably make these smaller. I just want to perfectly sequence them, and the best way to do that, as far as I'm aware, is to ensure that they're in, like, that they're only targeting specific groups. So half of this is, like, actual, like, grouping. So let me see. For falling, we set the scoreboard value of anyone who's below a certain Y value, and then we teleport them. We set their value to 2, and then we tell them to mind their step, and then we subtract any spirit if they have any, and then we set their scoreboard value to 0 again. I could probably switch that, but then people might get the same message twice, which, yeah, I'm not particularly happy. Yeah, avoid ripping off, exactly. Okay, that's the one I want. So, let's grab the contents there. Grab an anvil. But yeah, the great thing of doing this so that it's remote, so that it's all remote and compact like this and just groups, is I can just do it anywhere in the world. As soon as it's loaded, it works. That's the one. There. Okay. So now, I'll get myself telling me that I'm about to land, basically. So, let's see. Can I get up here? Just in time, I think. Yeah, lying whispers to me. Whew. Ha. So yeah, the more spirit you have, the further you can go. You can also, like, scroll with your mouse wheel to go faster or slower, but I don't personally recommend it, because you can exceed the chunks and lag the server to heck. Is it possible to set multiple functions for command blocks, which responds to dynamic situations such as the amount of power they're being hit with via redstone? Not to my knowledge. I don't think command blocks, like, have that degree of programmability to them. Okay. I didn't import these with any water, so I can't actually build a spring up here. It'd be interesting, but the main thing is, like, applying it to everybody at once, more or less. All the applicable parties get affected at the same time. Oh yeah, another thing that's worth remembering is, you can't fall into the void, you can still die of falling damage. So, building at heights is still a problem. In fact, I think there's an area over here on the mesa where you could actually die of falling damage ordinarily. Totally didn't do that on Undermine when Gleeful got introduced. Yes! I remember that. So yeah, Gleeful was our trader on Undermine currently, who is capable of putting you into spectator mode. Okay, so yeah, I think you could probably die of falling damage from here. So that's one option, there's another one probably. So yeah, you can totally die of falling damage, you just can't die of falling into the void, because the server prevents you. In a friendly manner, I think. And of course, then you have to find your way all the way back to where your items are. But at least if you fall into the void, you start off at the spring, so consequently you regain some spirit and you can be on your way. The thing that would be good, though, is to make sure there's a way for people to get bottles so they can have ethereal brew. That might require some kind of small quest. It is possible for me to make a quest. Some kind of like simplistic quest system for the actual spawn islands, so you do a thing and you get an ethereal, you get like just a bottle. Wouldn't be very much, because then you get a bottle, you chuck it in here, you get your brew. Done. The time Gleeful got closeted, not the server lagging. Oh, yeah, that happened as well. Which is part of why these need to be immovable. Will your Skylands map have vertical layers of islands? I don't know about vertical layers, but they're not all going to be on the same level. So you're, for example, there's the Extreme Hills Island will definitely be higher in the world than your desert island and stuff. Whistles innocently. So yeah, this is the simplest and cheapest way to get yourself some spirit, but it's also... it will be the slowest. It's currently the only one, so I've sped it up for testing purposes, but this will be the slowest, and it caps out at 300 spirit, which is enough to get you most places. But, or at least to the first islands. But there will be other ways, and there will definitely not be a max cap of spirit. It'll just be a limit of ways that can actually, like, increase your spirit. So the first and most obvious one is killing a boss. When the server no longer detects a given boss, it will actually, like, give you some spirit to everyone in the vicinity. There we go, 300. That's as high as this goes. I can probably use this for, like, other things as well, so I think I'm probably gonna place it around... I'm trying to think. 12 Flung is soaking in Spirit Spar. Yeah. Basically. Okay, so... when this goes off, it will indicate that this boss has stopped being around. Whew, that's a lot. Did I... I forget to, like, fix something around here, because, geez, that's a lot of cactus. Okay, we want Impulse, needs Redstone, / Scoreboard, Players, add everybody right now, Spirited, save, 300. So you get 300 from killing this particular boss. Not think this through, because I just realized he's going to be giving it either way. So let's see. Difficulty 1. Scoreboard player is set at P, spirited 300. Okay. Comparator. Silver torch. Okay. So now, the server is detecting that there is this particular boss. So, if I... let me see... / kill happy type equals pig zombie. I get 300 spirits immediately. And then it spawns in a new one, and I can do that later again. So, you can bet your butt I'm going to set up near a spring if they can spawn outside of spawn. Springs, not so much. Springs, I guess, are like a decent like hub point, but you're always going to go back to the spawn one. Will spirit be used for other things? Super running, speed fishing, pseudo bone meal? Not as many things as current Undermine does. Because I'll be honest, half of that was experimentation and me doing it in a really wonky way. I think there'll be special things. I might make it like a quest item, like a thing, like a quest, some kind of complicated, convoluted crafting system to get the anti-skulls and the anti-stars. There may be other things you can do that, like, I don't know, give you like beacon effects. Temporary beacons, for example, would be a nice little effect. But we'll see. Can see factions starting over players when I control over different spirit pools. Maybe. Not 100% certain how much I want to encourage factions is the main issue. Because having like that kind of interaction is interesting, but it heavily relies... It divides, it segregates, and that's not necessarily good for a server full of people. Especially a server full of people that have been paying every month to be there. So, yeah. Okay, one. Wait, so... Scoreboard, players, tag, at E type equals pig zombie, add boss mob, and save. And we're now detecting tag equals boss mob. So good, we're still detecting him. Slash kill at E. Tag equals boss mob. No longer detecting. Now detecting. Okay. So every time the boss pig goes down, we get that. Considering how we're like split between the corridors. Yeah. Like a dropped item behaving like a beacon until it despawns. Correct. It's been a while since I managed to catch the line while he's on. Yeah, sorry, Crush. Is my horizontally flipped, or is that buff with... No, it is flipped. Because the way the camera is set up, I am looking in this direction by default, but it makes more sense to have the camera oriented so I'm looking into the rest of the screen. So, yeah. Someone, I forget who exactly, but someone did suggest that I re-rig my old Races of the Five, or Races of the Four, I forget what number it was. Set up for the new server, which basically gave you different buffs and penalties, but I'm not 100% sure how much I want to do that. I mean, honestly, I like this system as it is already. This looks like a really interesting idea. And if you want to divide yourselves, like, along faction lines, you've got 16 islands. 16 big islands. Plenty of room for that. And maybe there'll be a few special islands as well, where at least parts, where like parts of them are restored, like a trading hub of some kind. Yeah. Oh, is that Aku? Okay. Thank you for reminding me that. So yeah, that's like this. Like for how much this adds, and for how small it is. Like I love this. It's beautiful, utterly beautiful. Oh yeah, something I can't really show off right now, I think. Hang on, let me try and get Remember Cam into here. Just sit over here, I guess. Because there is, like, one other little detail I think I can show off here. Because one thing that really, like, is problematic, I guess is the phrase, with spectator mode, is that you're completely invisible. Which is fine if you don't want to bug people, but it's also not necessarily great if somebody doesn't want to be bugged, like doesn't want to be watched, which is part of where the anti-skulls and whatnot comes in. And I am... Oh good. For a second there, I thought I was about to type in a password on camera. There we go, okay. So let me just open this to LAN. Springs will be white and neutral zone. If we do decide to do factions, we can decide then. Red, blue, yellow, and I don't know, green for the other banner. Can we use banners to designate who controls what island? It would need to be some kind of entity. Okay, bring Remember Cam in. Okay, there's Remember Cam. It was apparently already in spirit mode. Okay. Let's get Remember Cam all juiced up, as it were. Let's give you a little bottle of spirit. There you go. And now we're gonna get double sound, so this will be interesting. We wouldn't be so rude as to steal Remember Cam. It's more of what else you could access that worried me. Okay, so Remember Cam doesn't have a score. That is interesting. Let me see. Where is that given? It's given over here, so game mode 1. Now the trouble is, don't immediately have any way of telling who has what. So let me see. Let's just add a little bit. I guess here'll do. Okay. So we want this one to be on repeat. So slash scoreboard players set at a tag equals not. Setup, I guess. So don't have setup. Spirited 0. Just take to need redstone for now. And then chain scoreboard players tag at a tag equals not setup at setup. Okay. There we go. So that now means that people automatically get set up. Perfect! And you can have, like, multiple tags as well, so yay. Maybe you remember to have some pats, a cookie, whatever she wants, yeah. Okay, so I have no spirit, but remember cam is going up. There we go. So yeah, there's a little particle effect that I added to being in spirit mode, so we can just have a look at that. Just pass this through, okay. Okay. So 225, 250 should be fine. So yes, spirits actually have a visible particle effect. So if you're in spectator mode, you are still visible, but to everybody else. And then eventually, back you come. Perfect. Never seen Remember Cam in person like this before. Yeah. Don't think it liked the LAN? Okay, well that's fine, because I can close the server now. So, just wanted to show that last little bit off. We sometimes see the actual Remember Cam on the Undermines. Yes, if you want to see Remember Cam more often, you go there. So, with that, that allows you to know when someone is around, basically. Unless you turn off the particle effects, there's not much else I can do really beyond that. I might try giving them a glowing effect, but that seems a bit too unobtrusive because you can see that all the way through walls. But yeah. So, there is that. And combine that with these two items that control area effects on people who are in spirit mode, you can do some really interesting stuff. But, spirit is definitely going to be used for higher level stuff, and you're definitely going to need a fair bit of it. So, but nonetheless, I think we're good. So, let me see. Scoreboard players tag at p lung add lung. So let's see. Yeah, so I currently have all the tags I need. Scoreboard, players, tag, at P, list. So yes, my current tags are lung and setup. Setup means I've initialized. Lung is presumably something I'll use to just specifically target me. Or maybe I'll just borrow the one that I use for dungeons, that's another thing. Phew. So, hope you've all enjoyed. This has been a little look at the development of the Spring Realms, which will be coming up sometime around September. And will be accessible to everybody at the $15 or higher tiers on patreon.com/lying, which is fine, just take it to those links up there, really. But I hope you've enjoyed this little look. We've figured some stuff out and made some really interesting little mechanics. And I shall catch you all, as always, next time.